Welcome back. Today we are starting with a very important chapter called Judiciary. Now this chapter is of the NCERT booklet. आपके NCERT की जो book है उसका ये chapter है Judiciary. And this chapter deals with the justice system or you can say the judicial system of India. So when we talk about Judiciary, the first thing that should come to your mind is what exactly is Judiciary? We know that our constitution talks about three different organs of the government, right? In our country, we have three different organs. First is the legislature, second is the executive, third is the judiciary. And Indian constitution has established a very integrated judicial system. Because here in this judicial system, we have the Supreme Court at the top position. Then we have the High Court and then the District Courts and the Subordinate Courts. District Courts aa jate hain, Subordinate Courts aa jate hain. Theek hai? So this is the top-down aap dekh sakte ho system, the judicial system in India. Now below the High Court ke niche, we have the hierarchy of Subordinate Courts. And this entire, this is called as a single system of judiciary. Please write it down. Is point ko likh lijiye. It is known as, you can say, the single system of, judiciary. And the single system of courts was adopted from the government of, write it down, Government of India Act 1935. This act was used, using which we adopted this single system of courts. Ye jo single system of courts hai, ye humne kahan se adopt kiya hai? Government of India Act 1935 se. And this single system of court enforces the central laws also and the state laws also. चाहे वो सेंट्रल लॉज हो चाहे वो स्टेट लॉज हो दोनों ही लॉज ये सिंगल सिस्टम कोर्ट का जो है ये आपका चलाता है. ठीक है, पॉइंट क्लियर यहां तक? ऑल राइट, लेट्स मूव फॉरवर्ड, आगे बढ़ते हैं इन द इंडियन जुडिशरी सिस्टम. नाउ अनदर इंपॉर्टेंट पॉइंट इन दिस टॉपिक इज अनदर इंपॉर्टेंट दैट दिस इंडियन जुडिशरी सिस्टम ना इट इज वन ऑफ द ओल्डेस्ट जुडिशियल सिस्टम इन द वर्ल्ड. Judicial system of India is one of the most well known in the world and one of the oldest system of the world. And here in this judicial system, we follow the doctrine of separation. Right? Yahan par doctrine of separation ki baat ki jati hai. Separation of what? Separation of powers. It allows, this doctrine of separation of powers basically allows the authority to interpret the laws without any partiality, without any bias. So the judiciary does not just create statutory laws for the country, but it interprets the laws also. It applies those laws also. ऐसा नहीं हमारे judiciary system सिर्फ law बनाता है बैठकर, नहीं, उस law को constitution को interpret भी करता है. ठीक है, अगर कोई उसका misuse करे, कोई loophole use करके गलत इस्तेमाल करे तो वो उसे भी पकड़ लेता है and उस interpretation को apply भी करता है अपने day to day judgment में. ठीक है, यहां तक पॉइंट क्लियर हो गया. एंड देयर इज एन इंडिपेंडेंस ऑफ जुडिशरी इन आवर कंट्री. इंडिपेंडेंस ऑफ जुडिशरी मींस दैट एग्जीक्यूटिव एंड लेजिस्लेटिव ब्रांचेस ऑफ गवर्नमेंट दे डू नॉट इंटरफेयर विद जुडिशरीज एबिलिटी टू फंक्शन. ओके, द अदर ऑर्गन्स एक्सेप्ट द जुडिशरीज रूलिंग द डिसीजंस एंड दे डू नॉट इंटरफेयर विद इट. So it also applies that judges are free to carry out their duties without any fear of domination. And judiciary's independence, it does not imply that, you know, judiciary will operate arbitrarily without, you know, taking into consideration the law. No, because judiciary is the highest authority. It is responsible for the country's constitution. There are so many clauses, you know, in the constitution that guarantees judiciary's independence. That guarantees that judiciary's independence will be protected, will be preserved. All right. So these were the basic points about judiciary. Now let us understand further. We know that judiciary looks after the disputes in the nation. All the disputes in the nation are settled by one independent body and this is done in accordance with the rule of law. Law is used. Now what is rule of law? They can ask you. So in very simple terms, rule of law means where the rich and the poor, the men or women, the backward or the forward caste, all are subjected to the same law. There is no discrimination based on gender, based on, you know, कास्ट कम्युनिटी, उसके बेसिस पे कोई डिस्क्रिमिनेशन नहीं है, उसको हम रूल ऑफ लॉ बोलते हैं. एंड इंडिया वी फॉलो रूल ऑफ लॉ, रिमेंबर दैट. ओके, सो रूल ऑफ लॉ इन एसेंस मींस दैट नो मैन कैन बी अरेस्टेड पनिश्ड और कैन बी लॉफुली मेड टू सफर राइट ड्यू टू द प्रोसेस ऑफ लॉ एंड फॉर ब्रीच ऑफ अ लॉ एस्टैब्लिश्ड इन द ऑर्डिनरी लीगल मैनर. हेयर ऐसा नहीं है कि आप किसी भी इंसान को जस्ट ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ हिज जेंडर, जस्ट ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ हिज कलर और कास्ट और कम्युनिटी और ऑक्यूपेशन यू कैन मिसट्रीट अ पर्सन. नो, यू कैन नॉट डू दैट. एवरीबडी इज वन इन द आईज ऑफ लॉ. ठीक है, लॉ जो है वो बायस्ड नहीं है और जो यू नो लॉ है वो सबको इक्वली ट्रीट करता है. ऐसा नहीं है कि अमीर को हम बख्श देंगे और गरीब को सजा देंगे, ऐसा नहीं है. ठीक है, ये होता है रूल ऑफ लॉ का मतलब. दिस इज द मीनिंग ऑफ रूल ऑफ लॉ. सो रूल ऑफ लॉ हैज बेसिक थ्री काइंड ऑफ यू नो प्रिंसिपल्स. फर्स्ट इज एब्सेंस ऑफ आर्बिट्ररी पावर. दैट मीन्स जस्ट ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ योर ओन डिजायर्स यू कैन नॉट मेक अ जजमेंट. राइट, सो देर इज सुप्रीमेसी ऑफ लॉ. फर्स्ट प्रिंसिपल ऑफ रूल ऑफ लॉ इज, राइट इट डाउन, सुप्रीमेसी ऑफ लॉ. लॉ इज अबव ऑल. सेकेंड प्रिंसिपल ऑफ रूल ऑफ लॉ इज, सेकेंड प्रिंसिपल हो जाएगा इक्वालिटी बिफोर लॉ. लॉ से पहले इक्वालिटी होगी. ठीक है, नो वन इज अबव लॉ, लॉ से ऊपर कोई नहीं है. एंड थर्ड विल बी प्रीडोमिनेंस, राइट इट डाउन, प्रीडोमिनेंस ऑफ लीगल स्पिरिट. दिस इज द थर्ड इंपॉर्टेंट पॉइंट. लीगल स्पिरिट इन ऑल द जजमेंट्स, इन ऑल द डिसीजंस ऑफ द सुप्रीम कोर्ट, इट विल बी टेकन कीपिंग इन माइंड द लॉ, द लीगैलिटीज. Arbitrary decisions will not be taken. Okay? And this concept of rule of law was given by a constitutional expert called A.V. Dicey. A.V. Dicey ने इस concept को हमको दिया था. ये point आपको याद रखना है. This is important for prelims also. All right? Point clear हो गया यहाँ तक? This is subordinate courts. Okay? Now, ये points आपके बहुत important है. Now, the very important and principal role of judiciary is to protect rule of law. First, you know, principal role is to protect the rule of law, which was given by A.V. Dicey, which means that everybody is equal in the eyes of law. And second is to ensure the supremacy of law, to make sure that law is supreme. Law is not, you know, dominated or law is not suppressed. So, law ki supremacy ko ensure karna aur rule of law ko protect karna, ye do principal roles hote hain judiciary ke. So, judiciary safeguards the rights of individuals, of your, you know, your rights, and it settles the dispute in accordance with the law. It ensures that democracy is not, you know, basically leading to dictatorship or getting converted into dictatorship. And for that, we need to make sure that independence of judiciary is maintained in a country. अगर आप चाहते हो कि जुडिशरी रूल ऑफ लॉ को मेंटेन करे, लॉ की सुप्रीमेसी को बनाए रखे, तो आपको ये भी मेक श्योर करना पड़ेगा कि उसकी इंडिपेंडेंस को कोई हानि ना पहुंचे. Right, so that is why there are other organs of the government who are restrained from interfering in the functioning of judiciary. That is why there is a separation of power and a system of checks and balances which is existent in our democracy. Hamare nation mein checks and balances ka system hai aur hamare nation mein aapke yahan par हमने पॉइंट पढ़ा था. ओवर हियर आई विल जस्ट शो यू द पॉइंट. यस, सेपरेशन ऑफ पावर्स. ठीक है, सेपरेशन ऑफ पावर्स का भी सिस्टम है ताकि जुडिशरी के वर्किंग में कोई इंटरफेयर ना करे. एंड अनदर इंपॉर्टेंट पॉइंट टू मेंटेन इंडिपेंडेंस ऑफ जुडिशरी इज टू मेक श्योर दैट जजेस यू नो आर एबल टू परफॉर्म देयर फंक्शंस विदाउट एनी फियर और विदाउट एनी फेवर. सो इंडिपेंडेंस ऑफ जुडिशरी डज नॉट मीन दैट जुडिशरी कैन एक्ट यू नो विदाउट एनी अकाउंटेबिलिटी, विदाउट एनी रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी, यू नो विद आर्बिट्ररीनेस. नो, इट मीन्स दैट जुडिशरी इज एबल टू परफॉर्म देयर functions in accordance with the provisions of the constitution and in accordance with the laws as well. Okay, before we move ahead, here's a very quick announcement for all of you. Agar aap UPSC ki tayari karna cha rahe, if you are willing to prepare for UPSC, and if you want to get excellent guidance and mentorship in your preparation, you have doubts which you want to be cleared. Agar aap cha rahe ho ki ek discipline mein aap strategy ke sath, timetable ke sath padho, kuch aise educators ke sath padho jo aapke doubts jab aap chaho tab clear kar sake. So for that, Unacademy is providing this very wonderful offer right now, Unacademy Unlock, where in this offer, Unacademy is providing 20% discount on all the UPSC CSE subscription. UPSC ka na combo subscription Unacademy provides. In combo, you get the classes for prelims also, mains also, optional also, along with test series, answer writing sessions, doubt clearing sessions. You will get, 20 printed books as well. Aapko printed books bhi milengi, which will cover entire syllabus along with previous year questions, current affairs, and everything at just 55,000 rupees. 55,000. सारी तैयारी प्री से लेकर ऑप्शनल तक की सारी तैयारी यहाँ पर अनअकैडमी आपको करवा रहा है। एंड इसके ऊपर भी यू आर गोइंग टू गेट 10% डिस्काउंट इफ यू यूज माय कोड अर्पिता 10। अगर आप ये कोड यूज करते हो अर्पिता 10 ARPITA10 देन यू विल गेट 10% का डिस्काउंट ऑल्सो ऑन अनअकैडमी प्लस। सो दिस ऑफर इज वैलिड ओनली टिल 29th July। मेक श्योर दैट यू subscribe to this offer today. Now we know that the judiciary is accountable to the constitution, to the democratic traditions and then to the people of the country. That you have to remember. Ye point aapko yahan par yaad rakhna hai ki judiciary kiske prati accountable hai, jawabdeh hai, constitution ke prati, democratic traditions ke prati, jo bhi elections hote hain, jo bhi judgments hoti hain and logo ke prati. Okay, and legislature is not involved in the process of appointment of judges. That is another important point. As I told you, that independence of judiciary has to be maintained. That means legislature is not involved in the procedure of appointing the judges, or else you will see biasness or partiality. So to avoid that, legislature is not involved. Now to be appointed as a judge, a person must have experience as lawyer and must be well versed in law. Because if you have the experience of law, of being a lawyer, of, you know, studying law, then in that case, your decision-making ability will not be, you know, obstructed with anything else. जब लॉ की पकड़ आपको होती है, लॉ की समझ आपको होती है, तो आपके डिसीजन मेकिंग पावर को कोई डिस्टर्ब नहीं कर सकता। एंड द जज हैज अ फिक्स्ड टेन्योर, सो देयर इज अ सिक्योरिटी ऑफ टेन्योर आल्सो विद द जजेस, दैट यू हैव टू रिमेंबर। Now, judiciary, we have studied the independence of judiciary. We know that judiciary is not independent on executive or legislature. Same applies to the financial dependency also. Judiciary is not financially dependent on executive or legislature. That you have to remember. All right, point clear ho gaya yahan tak? So, in the appointment of judges, we need to understand that over the years, a convention had developed that the only senior most judge of Supreme Court will be appointed as Chief Justice of India. But even this convention was broken twice, once in 1973 and once in 1975. Now, in 1973, A.N. Ray was appointed as CJI and he was younger. You know, he had three senior most judges above him, but still he was appointed. In 1975, Justice M.H. Begg was appointed. He superseded Justice H.R. Khanna. So, basically over here, we need to understand that it makes a very huge difference as to who serves in the Supreme Court and High Court. Because if an incompetent person is made to become the Chief Justice of India or the Chief Justice of High Court, in that case, the interpretation of law may be negatively impacted. अगर आप किसी incompetent इंसान को Supreme Court का Chief Justice या High Court का Chief Justice बना देते हो, तो Constitution का interpretation, law का interpretation उसमें गड़बड़ हो जाती है। अगर उसमें गड़बड़ हो गई, तो पूरा आपके democracy का basis जो है, वही हिल जाएगा। And final, you know, the other judges of Supreme Court and High Court, they are appointed by President after consulting the Chief Justice of India. This is also another important point. Chief Justice of India se consult karne ke baad, President Supreme Court or High Court ke judges ko appoint karta hai. And here the final decisions in the matter of appointment are with the Council of Ministers. So this issue came up before the Supreme Court that finally, you know, the Council of Ministers is having, you know, as the predominant say in the appointment of judges. That is not correct. ये जब हुआ करता था हमारे कंट्री में अपॉइंटमेंट का प्रोसीजर सुप्रीम कोर्ट के, हाई कोर्ट के चीफ जस्टिस का, तो उसमें ये होता था कि प्रेसिडेंट सीजेआई से कंसल्ट करने के बाद काउंसिल ऑफ मिनिस्टर के फाइनल डिसीजन के बाद ही चीफ जस्टिस को अपॉइंट करेगा, यानी कि काउंसिल ऑफ मिनिस्टर्स के डिसीजन को लिया जा रहा है यहाँ पर। सो हियर द कोर्ट फेल्ट रोल ऑफ चीफ जस्टिस इज जस्ट कंसल्टेटिव, दैट इज रॉन्ग, ये तो गलत है, ये तो डिग्रेडिंग हो गई पोजीशन का। CJI का रोल सिर्फ कंसल्टेटिव रोल है, ऐसे तो होना नहीं चाहिए। एंड दैट इज व्हाई सुप्रीम कोर्ट केम अप विद अ सॉल्यूशन। सुप्रीम कोर्ट सेड देयर शुड बी प्रिंसिपल ऑफ कोलेजियलिटी इन द रिकमेंडेशन और अपॉइंटमेंट ऑफ सुप्रीम कोर्ट चीफ जस्टिस और द अदर जजेस एंड हाई कोर्ट जजेस एंड हाई कोर्ट चीफ जस्टिस। एंड दैट इज व्हाई वी रीड अबाउट और स्टडी अबाउट द कोलिजियन सिस्टम। आप कोलिजियन सिस्टम देखते होगे, राइट, पढ़ते होगे न्यूज़पेपर में। तो चीफ जस्टिस ऑफ इंडिया के पोजीशन को सिर्फ कंसल्टेटिव ना रखा जाए, उसको एक इंपॉर्टेंट पोजीशन मानकर अपॉइंटमेंट और रिकमेंडेशन में शामिल किया जाए, इसीलिए ये प्रिंसिपल ऑफ कोलेजियलिटी यूज किया जाने लगा। Supreme Court and Council of Ministers, they play a very important role, we know that. Here you have to remember that principle of collegiality, when we study about it, it is the core principle, it is the core legal principle, write it down. Ye hai aapka core, core means very important, core legal principle, or you can say foundational, okay, core legal principle of the, you know, Supreme Court's internal decision making. ये पॉइंट आपको यहाँ पर याद रखना है, ठीक है। नाउ वी हैव स्टडीड अबाउट द अपॉइंटमेंट ऑफ जजेस, नाउ व्हाट अबाउट द रिमूवल ऑफ जजेस। सो द सुप्रीम कोर्ट और यू नो हाई कोर्ट जजेस कैन बी रिमूव्ड ओनली ऑन ग्राउंड ऑफ इनकैपेसिटी और मिसबिहेवियर, व्हेन दे आर ब्रीचिंग द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन प्रोविजन, व्हेन दे आर मिसबिहेविंग, व्हेन दे आर नॉट केपेबल ऑफ यू नो गिविंग वर्डिक्ट्स और गिविंग जजमेंट्स और मेकिंग डिसीजंस। In that case, a special majority in both Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha is needed to remove the judges. Okay, point clear ho gaya yahan tak aapko? Now let's study about the structure of judiciary. You can see that here this, in India, the structure of judiciary is pyramidal. We have Supreme Court at the top, then we have High Court, then we have the District Courts, and then we have the subordinate courts. Supreme Courts have authority over High Court also, over District Court also, and subordinate court also. High court has the authority over district court and subordinate court, and district court will have the authority over subordinate courts. That you have to remember, top down approach hota hai. This is the hierarchy, single system of courts in India. Supreme court takes all the decisions, and supreme court's decisions are binding on all the courts. Supreme court ke jo decision hote hain wo sare courts par binding hote hain, sare courts, sabhi courts ko usko apnana padega. Supreme court can transfer judges of high courts. Supreme Court can move cases from the lower courts to itself. If there is any case in High Court or in any case in subordinate court which needs special attention, which is getting delayed, then Supreme Court will take away that case and transfer it to itself. It can transfer cases from one High Court to another High Court also. Now, when we study about High Court, we need to understand that High Court can hear appeals from the lower courts, that is the district and the subordinate courts. It can issue writs, this writ issue power we have studied in the chapter of social justice also. Humne justice wale chapter mein bhi is power ke baare mein padha tha. We studied about it in fundamental rights wala chapter also, so I'm not going to repeat it, okay? And High Court can deal with cases within the jurisdiction of the state. It can exercise superintendence and control over courts like district courts and subordinate courts. District courts, it considers the appeals on decisions given by lower courts, okay? And it decides cases which involve serious criminal offenses, etc. District mein jo bhi cases aate hain, wo district court ke paas jaate hain. Subordinate courts, they consider cases of both civil and criminal nature. So these are important points for your prelims point, perspective also. Let us understand about the functions and responsibilities of Supreme Court as defined by the Constitution. We know that functions within the limitations, the Supreme Court exercises its functions within the limitations which are imposed by Constitution. It cannot function arbitrarily. All right. So Supreme Court original, function of this particular court is that it settles the disputes between union and state and among different states. Union or state ke beech mein difference ho, ya do states ke beech mein koi dispute ho, to Supreme Court usse handle karta hai. It also tries the appeals from lower courts in civil and criminal and constitutional cases. Now one important thing is that subordinate courts, only look after the civil and criminal cases. Constitutional cases itne zyada subordinate courts ke paas nahi aate hain, wo Supreme Court aur High Court ke paas jaate hain. And Supreme Court exercises three kind of functions: original function, appellate function, and advisory function. We have studied these two. The advisory function is that Supreme Court gives advices to the president on those matters which are important from the public perspective, citizens perspective. Supreme Court can issue writs also. Supreme Court has special powers as well. It can grant special leave to an appeal from any judgment or matter which is passed by any court in the territory of India. Okay. So we can say that Supreme Court establishes itself as an empire in all the disputes regarding federal matters, regarding union or state or amongst the states. Jitne bhi federal matters hain, un sab ke upar empire ka kaam Supreme Court karta hai. It alone has the power to deal with such kind of cases which involves disputes and interpretation of powers. Okay, maan lo union government, state government ki powers ko interpret karne ka matter aaya hai, ki what kind of power they can exercise, Supreme Court will decide that. If any kind of dispute is happening between union and state or different states, then Supreme Court has to settle the dispute. Okay? Then Supreme Court also performs the advisory jurisdiction. The President of India can refer any matter that is of public importance on which President needs guidance to the Supreme Court. Okay? Supreme Court is not bound to give advice on such matters. And the President is also not bound to accept such an advice. So the question is, what is the use of advisory power of Supreme Court? If Supreme Court is not bound to give advice and President is not bound to accept it, then what is the utility of this kind of jurisdiction? सिंपल मीनिंग यही हो गया ना कि भाई सुप्रीम कोर्ट जरूरी नहीं है कि बाध्य है कि वो उस तरीके की एडवाइस दे, या प्रेसिडेंट बाध्य है कि उस एडवाइस को यूज करे, तो फिर फायदा क्या हुआ इसका। बट द यूटिलिटी इज टू फोल्ड। वॉट इज द यूटिलिटी ऑफ दिस एडवाइजरी ज्यूरिस्डिक्शन? फर्स्ट इज दैट इट अलाउज द गवर्नमेंट टू सीक लीगल ओपिनियन इफ इन केस देर इज अ मैटर ऑफ इंपॉर्टेंस एंड गवर्नमेंट इज नॉट यू नो क्लियर कि वॉट काइंड ऑफ डिसीजन वी शुड टेक, then government will look up to Supreme Court. And you know, as a, it is just written that president is not bound to accept the advice, or Supreme Court is, you know, it is not bound to give the advice. But in reality, if the president or the government is in confusion, they approach the Supreme Court for help. If the Supreme Court wants, sees that the president and government is, are not taking the correct decision, then Supreme Court steps in, offers its advice. Okay? And second is that the government can make suitable changes in its actions and legislations in light of Supreme Court's advice also. If government is not willing to accept the advice completely, then it can make necessary changes in its, you know, legislations or actions according to the advice of Supreme Court. Decisions made by Supreme Court are binding on all the other courts within the territory of India, but not binding on the president. Supreme Court, you know, the advice of Supreme Court is not binding, but the decision is binding. That you have to remember. Now, another important concept when it comes to the powers of Supreme Court is judicial activism. What is judicial activism? There is a separate chapter on judicial review and judicial activism in the M. Lakshmikant book of Indian Polity. Judicial activism signifies proactive role of judiciary in protecting the rights of the citizens. It was, you know, first developed in USA. Pehli bar ye USA mein hi originate hua tha. This term was given by historian Arthur Schlesinger in 1947. And was developed and originated in USA. And in India, its foundations were laid down by Justice V.R. Krishna Iyer, P.N. Bhagwati, O. Chinnappa Reddy, and Justice Deye Desai. Ye aapko point yaad rakhna hai, prelims ke liye. These are important points for prelims. So what exactly is judicial activism? Let us understand. Pehle ye samajh lete hain ki judicial activism ka na matlab kya hota hai. Because if we understand the meaning, then we'll understand the concept. So judicial activism, it is an approach to the exercise of judicial review. Or a description of particular judicial decision in which a judge is generally considered more willing to decide constitutional issues and to invalidate legislative or executive actions. So basically you can say it is an, write it down, it is an exercise of the power of judicial review to set aside government acts, to set aside government एक्ट्स। कोई गवर्नमेंट एक्ट जो आपको लग रहा है, जजेस को लग रहा है कि भाई सही नहीं है, तो जुडिशियल रिव्यू का पावर यूज करके आप उस गवर्नमेंट एक्ट को साइड में रख सकते हो। ये होता है जुडिशियल एक्टिविज्म। ऑलराइट, फॉर एग्जांपल, आई विल गिव यू एन एग्जांपल आल्सो, राइट? दिस जुडिशियल एक्टिविज्म इट स्टार्टेड व्हेन अलाहाबाद हाई कोर्ट रिजेक्टेड द कैंडिडेचर ऑफ इंदिरा गांधी इन 1973। ओके, तो यहाँ पर अलाहाबाद के हाई कोर्ट ने इंदिरा गांधी जी के कैंडिडेचर को रिजेक्ट कर दिया था। कैसे? जुडिशियल एक्टिविज्म के पावर से। सो इन लेमैन्स टर्म, जुडिशियल एक्टिविज्म मींस रूलिंग्स ऑफ द कोर्ट बेस्ड ऑन पॉलिटिकल एंड पर्सनल रैशनल एंड प्रूडेंस ऑफ द जजेस प्रिसाइडिंग ओवर द इशू। इट इज अ लीगल टर्म रेफरिंग टू द कोर्ट रूलिंग्स विच आर बेस्ड इन पार्ट और इन फुल ऑन द पॉलिटिकल और पर्सनल फैक्टर्स ऑफ द जज। Okay, point clear? All right. And judicial activism has, you know, you can say evolved through the process of judicial review only. Okay, now the question is, ma'am, we have understood judicial activism, that the Supreme Court is exercising its power to basically set aside government acts or government's actions. So what exactly is judicial review? Judicial review is the power of the court to consider the constitutionality of acts or the organs of government. Judicial review के through the Supreme Court or High Court can declare any act or any principle of the Constitution as unconstitutional or you know violative in nature. Government का कोई भी act या कोई भी action judicial review के through judges जो हैं unconstitutional या violative करार कर सकते हैं। Because judicial review means looking at each and every act or legislation or power of the government or function of the government through the prism of the Constitution. Okay? And in India, Supreme Court and High Court are vested with the power to examine the constitutionality of any law. This you have to remember. If such a law is found to be inconsistent with the provision of constitution, then using judicial activism through the process of judicial review, the court can prove it as unconstitutional. So judicial review is a process. The final action is judicial activism. Okay? Now there is another controversy in regard to the supremacy between Parliament and Supreme Court, because Parliament is making the laws, right, and implementing the laws. So here there is controversy, who is superior? Parliament is superior or Supreme Court is superior? And this controversy can disturb the delicate principle of separation of powers and checks and balances. So judicial activism has had a manifold impact on political system, and it has even democratized the judicial system, right? Hamare Indian ke judicial, India ke judicial system ko democratize bhi kiya hai judicial activism ne. Right? But it has forced executive accountability. It has made an attempt to make the electoral system much more free and fair. Why it has forced executive accountability? By asking questions to each and every action or legislation passed by the government. So there is, however, a negative side to, you know, to this particular judicial activism concept. In the first place, it has overburdened the courts. Why? Because now, using judicial activism, the courts have to go through each and every legislation, each and every activity of the government. There will be number of cases, because there are so many PILs which are filed every year in the court, questioning government's authority, government's functions, government's power, and using judicial activism, courts have to look into that. So that has overburdened the courts. Secondly, judicial activism has blurred the line of distinction between executive and legislature. Because on the one hand, you know, the parliament is forming laws and, you know, taking actions, passing policies and acts for the citizens. And on the other hand, the citizens are filing PILs, and judiciary has to go through the PIL and has to again overlook the acts and the programs and policies passed by the parliament. So it causes delay in decision making also. Plus, it also blurs the line between parliament and Supreme Courts. पॉइंट क्लियर हो गया. होता क्या है कि PILs फाइल करके सिटीजंस, यू नो, गवर्नमेंट के हर एक्ट, हर पॉलिसी, हर प्रोग्राम को क्वेश्चन करते हैं, और जब PIL फाइल हुई है तो कोर्ट को इसमें देखना भी पड़ेगा. जुडिशियल एक्टिविज्म का, यू नो, पावर यूज करके कोर्ट को हर एक्ट, हर प्रोग्राम को स्क्रूटनाइज करना पड़ेगा. तो पार्लियामेंट और, यू नो, यहाँ पर जुडिशरी, उनकी सुप्रीमेसी के बीच की जो लाइन है वो ब्लर होती जा रही है. समझ ही नहीं आता कि फिर सुप्रीम कौन हुआ, जुडिशरी हुई कि पार्लियामेंट हुई. Okay, this is the, you know, controversy which has been in news since so many years. Now let us understand judicial review, right, in a very depth, you know, in an in-depth manner. So hum judicial review ko jab baat karte hai, we know that it is a type of court proceeding. I told you that it's a process. It's a type of court proceeding in which judge reviews the lawfulness or constitutionality of a decision or action made by a public body. Ek public body ya koi bhi organization jo bhi action leta hai, ठीक है, उस एक्शन का जो, यू नो, कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल प्रोविजंस के हिसाब से कितनी वैलिडिटी है, ये चेक करने की पावर होती है जुडिशियल रिव्यू. ये पूरा प्रोसीजर होता है जिसके थ्रू जजेस ये देखते हैं कि ये जो एक्शन गवर्नमेंट ले रही है ये कितनी कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल है, कितनी लॉफुल है. इन अदर वर्ड्स यू कैन से जुडिशियल रिव्यूज आर अ चैलेंज टू द वे इन विच डिसीजन हैज बीन मेड. ओके, पॉइंट क्लियर. एंड देयर आर टू काइंड ऑफ थिंग्स विच आर टेस्टेड in judicial review. First is the procedure established by law. It means that a law enacted by legislature or the concerned body is valid only if the correct procedure has been followed. If correct procedure has not been followed, then the judges using judicial review can, you know, call that or term that law as incompetent or void or invalid. Second is due process of law. It is a doctrine that not only checks if there is a law to deprive the life and personal liberty of a person, but also ensures that the law is made fair and just. All right. So basically, if during, you know, by passing that particular act or, you know, policy or a program, the government has followed the due procedure of law or not, and if that law has been established, you know, if that particular act has been established by law or not, these two things are tested in the procedure of judicial review. And India over here follows the procedure established by law. India is procedure ko follow karta hai. So in India, judicial review is tested through this procedure. Through this particular principle. Okay, in other countries, due process of law is also followed. Okay. Now, आगे बढ़ते हुए, we have to remember that judicial review is considered as the basic structure of the constitution, and we know that judges of Supreme Court have ruled out, you know, passed this ruling that the basic structure of the constitution should never be disturbed. Okay, so in the Indira Gandhi versus Raj Narayan case, it was given the verdict that judicial review is considered as a basic structure, you cannot disturb it. It is also called the interpretational and observer roles of the Indian judiciary, that you have to remember. Hence, judicial review is very important for maintaining the supremacy of not the judiciary or not the parliament, but the constitution. जुडिशियल रिव्यू में सुप्रीम कोर्ट की, हाई कोर्ट की या जुडिशियल सिस्टम की सुप्रीमेसी नहीं establish की जाती, constitution की जाती है. It is essential, it is very important for checking if there is any possible misuse of power by parliament or the executive. It protects the rights of people, it maintains the federal balance in the country. And any kind of monarchy or tyranny of executives is prevented using judicial review. That is why it is very important. Okay, now the difference between judiciary and parliament is very simple. It is separation of power and system of checks and balances. That is the difference between judiciary and parliament. Each organ of the government, whether it is judiciary, legislature or executive, has a clear area of functioning. We need to remember that. Parliament has to make laws and amend the constitution. Executive has to implement those laws. Judiciary has to check if those laws are in accordance with the provision of the constitution or not. These are the different functions that each organ of the government performs. So we need to remember that in a parliamentary system, legislature has power to govern itself and regulate the behavior of its members. So legislature can punish a person who the legislature holds guilty of breaching privileges of legislature, and judiciary will not interfere in this power of the legislature. That is why there is a system of separation of powers. Okay, constitution provides the conduct of judges, right? And it cannot be discussed in the parliament. That is why there is a separation of power in judiciary, between the judiciary and between the parliament. इसलिए दोनों एक दूसरे के काम में, working में interfere नहीं करते. दोनों के अपने अलग powers हैं. अपने members को कैसे punish करना है, वो भी stated है. And that is why there is harmony between the three organs of the government. All right. So this is the homework for you for today. Yeah, aaj ka aapka homework hai. What do you mean by judicial activism? List down its significance. Very easy question. Judicial activism ko aapko define karna hai. You can give examples also that we discussed. Indira Gandhi wala case humne discuss kiya tha. And you can list down the importance of judicial activism. Now here they are saying list down. That means you have to list down numerically. Theek hai, is tarike se aapko chronological order mein isko list down karna hai. Theek hai? Question number 2 is saying, do you think judicial activism can lead to conflict between judiciary and executive? Why? Agar aapka answer yes hai, explain your answer. If it is no, explain your answer. Kya aapko lagta hai judicial activism judiciary aur executive ke beech mein conflict la sakta hai? Agar haan to kyun? Agar na to kyun? Maine aapko bataya hai difference between parliament and judiciary, the blurring of the lines, that you have to explain. Third question, what are the different provisions in the constitution in order to make independence of judiciary? So here the different provisions are separation of power, system of checks and balances, and these three points that we studied in the beginning of the lecture. Okay, ye point aapko samjhane hai. So here the first provision will be, pehla provision kya hoga? That, write it down, that the conduct of judges cannot be discussed. Cannot be discussed in parliament. Parliament mein judges ka conduct discuss nahi kiya jayega. This over here. This is the first provision through which independence of judiciary can be maintained. Second provision is that the legislature is not involved in the process of appointment of judges. ठीक है, principle of collegiality that we studied previously. Okay, and third provision will be that the judges have fixed tenure. ये हमने starting में पढ़ा था, fixed tenure which ensures that the judges can work fearlessly. Point clear हुआ? This is the third important provision that you need to remember. Okay, then another fourth provision क्या होगा? That the removal of judges of Supreme Court and High Court is extremely difficult. Okay, it is not easy, not very easily. You cannot remove the judges. They can be removed only on grounds of incapacity or violation of constitution, not any other ground. Okay? Then we know that the authority of judges protects them from any unfair criticism, and judiciary can penalize those who are guilty of contempt of court. So these are the provisions through which independence of judiciary can be maintained. Now, fourth question is, write a short note. This is note, okay? Note on your understanding of this chapter. So you have to summarize this chapter, what you have studied and understood, in 2 pages. 10 marks means 2 pages. Aapko aapke words mein, is chapter mein aapne jo bhi padha hai, usko summarize karna hai. This question will test your writing ability. This question will test how much you have understood, how much you have learned and retained by going through the chapter. Very important question. So this was your chapter on judiciary. Ye tha aapka pura chapter judiciary ke upar. I hope you enjoyed this lecture. If you have any doubts, you can ask me in the comment section.